Hello everyone, welcome to this course on Exadata Cloud Service Overview. My name is Bal Sharma, I am part of Oracle Cloud Infrastructure Product Management team. Before we get into this course, this is our safe harbor statement. I will take a pause here so that you can read it. In this course, we are going to discuss Exadata Cloud Service on Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. I believe you should have gone through our foundation level course on Oracle Cloud Infrastructure for a better understanding of several concepts which are applicable to Exadata Cloud Service, which I am going to discuss further in this session. At the end of this training, you should have an understanding on what is Exadata Cloud Service on OCI. You should be able to understand various components of Exadata engineered system. I am going to briefly cover Exadata basics as well. I will spend some time to explain for those who are new to Exadata system. We will learn how ExaCS is architected on OCI. We will also look at a typical ExaCS deployment architecture blueprint followed with how to provision them on OCI. Some of the best practices for deployment as well as consolidation. And at the end, I will take you through a demo where I will briefly show you Exadata Cloud Service Environment provisioning steps, and I will log into ExaCS system to show you a few basic stuff. So let's start. We provide Exadata Cloud Service on OCI platform across several OCI regions. As you might already know, OCI is hosted in regions and availability domains. Region is basically geographical area, and availability domains are one or more data centers located within regions. It comes in different shapes like quarter rack, half rack, and full rack configurations, and users have an option to pick the desired shape during provisioning based on their subscription. Exadata rack consists of database nodes, sometimes you also say it compute node, storage nodes, and networking components like InfiniBand connectivity, switches, etc. The storage and compute nodes are connected via InfiniBand, and it also takes advantage of remote direct memory access for connecting with compute nodes. Exadata storage software runs on a storage server, and it offloads database SQL processing overheads. So we will discuss further in the course about like how it does SQL processing, and you will see some more detail on that. So currently, we provide a single virtual machine per compute node, and it also allows root access for customers, while we are able to protect the hardware and network. Database nodes are virtualized using Zen-based OVM. Oracle manages the storage cells, switches, management, or InfiniBand network, and customers are able to manage their database and compute nodes. Exadata Cloud Service provides a control plane, basically a web-based self-service management interface for Exadata provisioning, and there is an interactive access to service administration function. So now we'll look at ExaCS operational overview. So we provide REST APIs as to provide the service administration functions. Applications can connect to Exadata Cloud Service database, and it can use any standard JDBC or SQL StarNet-based connections from OCI or on-prem, or it can be on any other cloud-based deployments. So you need to establish a secure sales session with Exadata Compute Service for connecting to Exadata instance, and SSS is the way like you connect to those compute nodes. ExaCS uses network interfaces and subnets which are exclusively for database backups to an Oracle Storage Cloud Service buckets. And there is a separate network, which is for called as client subnet, and it is used for database connections. There is another separate network, which is used for admin tasks that is called Ethernet Zero and ILOM access. Customers facing API for Exadata management are integrated with OCI management console, and essentially, customer can control API access via standard identity authorization policies. We'll look at ExaCS management. So customers are able to manage database compute nodes and they have root privileges with them through sudo. Components managed by Oracle are network switch, storage cells, power distribution units, and ILOM interfaces. Customers have full administrative privilege on database, and they can perform operations like database backups, recovery, they can run performance diagnostic, etc. XRCS runs on Enterprise Edition Extreme Performance version. So for those like who are not familiar of what exactly Extreme Performance version means, this is the one cloud service like which includes all the database options and Enterprise Manager packs. So there are several database options and EM packs, including advanced compression, partitioning, rack, multi-tenant, in-memory. The same with EM packs, diagnostic tuning, real application testing, cloud management pack. So they all are part of this extreme performance version, and Exadata is taking advantage of that. So all database instances are configured with huge pages for their memory management. And this is default. When you deploy a Exadata cloud system, there is a starter database that comes with all these huge pages configured. Customers can also customize syslog format for log analytics and better integration with SIEM products. And we are able to provide customers access to the storage cell via XRCLI APIs. And one thing to note here is like block storage volumes cannot be attached to Exadata compute nodes currently. So there is a reason for it. Like Exadata comes with a lot of storage space, like even in a quarter rack configuration, you have more than 100 terabyte of usable disk capacity, and you have roughly 75 terabyte of flash disk in it. So we are not supporting block storage currently to be attached to Exadata system. With Exadata cloud service, you can either store your backups locally or in the OCI object storage. So OCI object storage is for your cloud backup, and the recovery area, which will be part of your Exadata deployment, can be used for your local Armin backups or any on-demand backups. So we'll look at Exadata cloud service networking. So each of the compute or database node has four 10 gig data or backup ports, one gig admin port and one gig ILOM port. Storage nodes have the 1 gig admin and ILOM ports for management purposes. Exadata in OCI platform are integrated with VCN, which is known as Virtual Cloud Network, wherein the customer's visible database nodes are presented via regular virtual NICs in customer's VCN. So as part of the deployment, when customer creates a subnet in a VCN, they are taking advantage of regular VCN APIs. And as part of deployment, customers calls the Exadata service API to allocate an Exadata quarter rack or any other SAP they are interested in deploying, and they pass it in the subnet. So four VNICs will be allocated on each subnet, two for database client traffic and two for database backup traffic. So there are multiple private IP addresses which will be allocated as part of the deployment. And for that one, each VNIC are required by database rack software, like a scan host, which itself needs like certain IP addresses to be registered in the DNS server, as well as the floating IP, which is nothing but your virtual IP, if you are familiar with a rack terminology. So database client in the VCN can access the Exadata database node via private addresses. Customers can use all the standard VCN feature, including any security list or routing rules, to control network access to their database nodes. Additionally, customers might be deploying a VPN through Cisco IPsec connectivity or maybe the fast connect options in order to connect from their data center to Oracle Cloud infrastructure. The other component, which is Service Gateway, they provide connectivity to OCI object storage. And OCI object storage, we are going to use that for our cloud backup on Exadata. NAT Gateway, which provides network connectivity to Exadata cloud service compute nodes, and the use case for that one is to get the required patches and updates, and also security because communication can happen from Exadata node to outside, but those connections which are coming from outside to Exadata system is not going to happen because of the network address translation in place. So now we will take a look at Exadata Cloud Service Architecture on OCI. So here, each Exadata database server contains at least one virtual machine, and that is also known as DOMU. They are running on a VM hypervisor known as DOM0, and this configuration also ensures there is a distinct separation between the Oracle managed and customer managed components. So Oracle manages the hardware, firmware, and DOM0 by using ILOM and DOM0 management network interfaces. Customers have no access to these interfaces. Minimal resources are allocated to DOM0. And what we do is, like, from each compute node, only 2 CPU cores and 16 GB of RAM is allocated for DOM0. So here in this diagram, it is Exadata Cloud Service quarter rack configuration. And that's why you see 2 DOM0s from 2 compute nodes. So each DOMU is provisioned with a complete Oracle database installation. It has all the features of Database Enterprise Edition plus all the Database Enterprise Management Packs. And it runs Real Application Cluster, Grid Infrastructure Software. Customers has secure access to each DOMU, and they use their client network as well as backup networks here for sending their backups to either like cloud infrastructure object storage or to the local disk. So operating system security for DOMU is basically based on SSH public and private key pair. Customers basically register a public key in each DOMU, and then like they need to have access to their private keys in order to connect from the DOMU. So based on this diagram, you see that customers are able to manage DOMU, which are shown here in gray color, and all these red colors, DOM0 as well as Exadata storage cell, are managed by Oracle. So now take a look at Exadata Cloud Service X7 hardware infrastructure. Though OCI is able to provide you Exadata X6 also, but I have just mentioned the latest version which is available as of today. So in a quarter rack configuration, if you look at database nodes are 2, in half rack configuration it's 4, and in full rack 8. The maximum number of OCPUs which a quarter rack configuration supports can go all the way from 0 to 92. And when I say 0, means you can shut down your DOMU, and that time only infrastructure cost is going to be factored for XRCS environment. So in a half rack configuration, the maximum number of OCPUs supported are 184, and in a full rack it can go all the way up to 368. So total memory or DRAM in a quarter rack configuration is roughly 1.5 terabyte. In a half rack configuration it's roughly 3 terabyte, and in a full rack configuration it is going to be roughly 6 terabyte. So number of storage servers, they also varies depending on the shape. And in a quarter rack configuration, it's 3, in half rack 6, and in full rack, you will get 12 storage cells. So total flash capacity is going to be roughly 76 terabyte on a quarter rack configuration, 153 terabyte on a half rack, and 300 plus terabytes on a full rack configuration. And when it comes to the spinning disk, like that is, roughly 106 terabyte on quarter rack and 200 terabyte on half rack and 427 terabyte on full rack configuration. So one note here is you need to plan the shape of XRCS service based on the sizing. You can scale up or down within the shape. Currently, we are not supporting scaling across shape. For example, if you want to upgrade from a 1/4 rack to a half rack, it is going to require redeployment. So just a note to keep in mind. Now we will try to understand XRCS customer versus Oracle managed. So customer, as you saw in the Exadata architecture, they manages the VM or DOMU, and Exadata Cloud Ops, they manage everything else. So the initial VM or GI or configuration and install or Exadata storage server management, that might include the patching of those storage cells as well, right? DOMU, including configuration as well as patching, InfiniBand switches, management network, including ILOMs, all the hardware, firmware, and BIOS, as well as client access VLANs, where you whitelist some addresses or like you set some firewall rules. So they are all managed by Oracle Exadata Cloud Ops team. What customer manages here is the guest VM, DOMU, and that includes the operating system and kernel. Customers has VM root access through SSH, Oracle Database, Grid Infrastructure Software, and ASM. Any database bundle patch and updates is customer responsibility. Oracle provides the required tooling, and also that is maintained by Cloud Ops team. And those tools are available to facilitate the patching required on those compute nodes. Database operating system backups. So again, like Oracle is providing you tooling to do the database backup or OS backup. There are several APIs available like backup underscore API. So they take care of database and OS backups. Though you need to enable it, like you have to schedule it one time and then those backups will be taken care of. So database OS monitoring or cloud DOMU. So we provide Enterprise Manager Express that can be used for monitoring this database and operating system level matrices. Also the database and OS monitoring from on-prem EM deployment can be done, especially if you are already using a OEM cloud control in your on-prem and you want to leverage the same to monitor the Exadata cloud service environment. So that can be done. So now we have Exadata typical deployment architecture, and this is one of the architecture you can consider as a blueprint. And what I'm trying to show you here is how Exadata can be deployed. So Exadata in isolation, you are not going to deploy. You will always have certain applications or certain workloads, and you might need to factor them. So in this example, I'm showing that there is an availability domain. So definitely Exadata has to be deployed within a region, and within region, it will be in one of the availability domains. So I have an availability domain. Inside that, I have a virtual cloud network, and which is associated with a CIDR block, which is 10.0.0.0/16 here. And here, one thing if you notice, like I'm using all the private subnets for my Exadata, for my application workload. So there could be several compute running on OCI infrastructure, and they all can be associated with a private subnet. And the goal here is like we don't want to expose our critical production workload on the internet, right? That's the reason like I have factored a Bastion server here, which is the only server running on a public subnet. So that is required like if you are especially connecting over internet to Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. And this can act as a proxy, and you can navigate to any one of these servers which are hosted on OCI. So especially if you have a VPN in place or a fast connect kind of options from your data center, you can design the way you want your networking to be. But this is one of the best practice to have a Bastion server and workload to be running on a private subnet. These private subnet can be associated with private routing table. So here, if you notice, we have a NAT gateway, which is needed for Exadata cloud service. And they provide all the required patches and operating system upgrades. So database patches as well as the operating system patches come through this NAT gateway to compute nodes. There is another component here, like we discussed, is service gateway. And the main task of service gateway is to provide connectivity to object storage, which is going to be used for storing your cloud backup. Then, like we have the standard framework in place with respect to identity and access management, all sort of auditing will take place here on the platform. And now later in the slide, like we will look at how to build this particular deployment when it comes to Exadata provisioning. So before going to that, I have included a topic on Exadata basics, like why Exadata performs, what are the basic components within that. So some of you might be familiar if you have worked on Exadata environment, but for some, it could be just a refresher. So this slide you might have seen if you attended any Oracle classes on Exadata system. But what I'm going to show you or explain here is like this Exadata machine, which is a 42U rack, what it has internally and what are the different features which makes it different than any other traditional platform. So it has database nodes, and database nodes in this rack is going to run database starting from 11G through 18C, right? It runs real application cluster. So cluster and the database run on the server, known as database nodes or compute nodes. In a full rack configuration, you have 8 nodes running Oracle Linux. The storage cells are the one like which will be storing all the data from the database, right? And we call it a storage cell, and each storage cell is going to have basically 12 disks in it, right? And if we talk about Exadata X7, like it will be 10 terabyte disk each. And so you can see on a one storage cell, you will have roughly 120 terabyte of raw disk space. So in a smallest configuration, you have roughly 360 terabyte raw disk. Then this disk, as I said, like it's 10 terabyte and it's known as high capacity disk. In Exadata world, like we have another variant which is known as like Extreme Class, but when it comes to Exadata cloud service, we have this high capacity disk configurations, and it has like enough NVMe flash RAM, flash devices as well. So these flash devices is available on each of the storage cell, and each storage cell is going to have 4 of 6.4 terabyte of flash disk. So they are presented to the compute node as a storage, or like it can be used as a secondary cache for database cluster. We call it a smart cache. So another component within the box is InfiniBand, and the cell and the storage cells as well as the compute nodes are connected through InfiniBand. And that is for the reason like it provides the low latency network between these. So there are redundant InfiniBand switches for the speed and the throughput, and there are no fiber within this configuration. So in normal traditional SAN, you connect through a fiber cable, but in this Exadata, like we have InfiniBand taking care of that. So there are additional Ethernet switches, which is for like communicating with the outside world, and there are set of Ethernet switch and the port open to the outside, and client may connect to the nodes using Ethernet. So in a typical Exadata environment, there could be a KVM switch, right? And not necessarily all of the configuration has a KVM switch, but it might contain that. The most important aspect on Exadata server is, if you are familiar, you might have heard of the secret sauce, which is Exadata storage server. So if you are familiar with Exadata storage server, you should be understanding like what tasks are performed by Exadata storage server. Like it could be cell offloading, where the storage in the Exadata database machine performs several SQL offload processes. So it is not a dumb storage like traditional storage systems. They are intelligent enough to process some of the workload inside them, and that saves the database node from doing work, right? So this process, like which does the offloading, we call it cell offloading, and the exact nature of the offloading activity could be related with a smart scan. And a smart scan is nothing but it's for predicate filtering. So predicate filtering means only the requested rows are returned as part of the database operation, and there could be column filtering as well. So only the requested columns are returned back to the database node. So in a traditional Oracle database, when user selects a row or even a single column in a row, the entire block containing that row is fetched from the disk to the buffer cache. And the selected rows in that one is then extracted from the block and presented to the user session. So in database machine, the process holds true for most type of access except a very important few like direct path access, for instance. So full table scans and full index scans are done differently. So this feature which does help with SQL processing is known as a smart scan. And the main idea of doing is like it saves a lot of IOs within the database system. So now we'll take a look at what other components makes Exadata unique. So one of the thing like what we did is the intelligent database protocol. So the storage cells and the compute node, they talk through intelligent database protocol. So what IDP does is like it sends the name of the table, the column, the predicates, and any other relevant information which is requested in the query to a storage cell. So that information allows the cell to learn a lot more about the query instead of just the address of the block to retrieve. The another cool feature here in Exadata is a storage index. And so normal indexes are used to zero in on the location where the rows are most likely to be found. But a storage index are used just for the opposite region, where the rows are most likely not to be found. So this kind of filtration happens within the storage cell and it is carried out by the storage indexes. The another important aspect in Exadata system is a smart cache. And the smart cache provide capability to stage active database object in the flash. And the another feature like which is provided by this flash cache is flash logging, and that is to speed up the critical function of data. So hybrid columnar compression is included on Exadata systems. So this option basically provides very high level of data compression. It is implemented inside the Exadata storage server. And this feature allows the database to reduce the number of physical IOs required to scan a table. So you can specify Exadata hybrid columnar compression at various levels. It could be table level or partition level or table space level. You can also decide on which kind of hybrid columnar compression you want to apply on those database objects. So there are basically two of them. One is warehouse compression. So that option is for optimizing query performance and it is suitable for data warehouse kind of application. So they are known as query high and query low. There are another type of compression which is known as archival compression, and that is optimized for maximizing compression ratios suitable for data change that is happening very rarely. So two of the options which are provided by this archival compressions are archive high and archive low. Another unique feature within Exadata machine is IO resource management, and the goal of IORM is to provide basically resource management capability, especially if you have consolidated many databases on the system. So you can prioritize the IO. Each cell maintains a kind of IO queue for each consumer groups and for each of the databases. We also built in-memory fault tolerance, which is very unique to Exadata. And this is not provided on any other platform. It is related to database in-memory technology. And as I said, like it uses InfiniBand, like we have ExaFusion, which is nothing but direct-to-wire protocol, which is unique to Exadata system. And in the left side, you see all of the database options, including multi-tenant, in-memory database, rack, active data guard partitioning. So you must be familiar with these database options. So they are common to any other platform. You can have these database options licensed in several other environments. But on right-hand side, these features are unique to Exadata system and they are foundation for Exadata Cloud Service. So let's take a look at Exadata Cloud Service operating system. So we support Linux on Exadata Cloud Service, and the latest version which is available is Oracle Linux 7. And one of the reason for moving to Linux 7 is Database 19c that is only supported on this particular platform. And all of our autonomous transaction processing processing systems, like they run Database 19. So bare metal and guess like DOMU, or like it supports basically all generation of hardware, including 2 socket and 8 socket servers. It has support for all the cell, bare metal, or DOM0 and DOMU database nodes. It supports multiple ways to image and update the hardware, and support upgrades between major Linux releases. Another main reason for moving to Exadata operating system as version 7 was to do rolling upgrade, and it also supports zero downtime patching. So that was the reason behind moving to Exadata Oracle Linux. Let's take a look at Exadata software architecture. So there are 3 main Exadata storage cell processes provided by Exadata storage service. So first one is cell service. Cell service is the primary component of the Exadata software running in the cell, and also provides the majority of Exadata storage services. So it services database requests for disk IO and advanced Exadata cell services. It is implemented as a multi-threaded process and uses the largest portion of the CPU or processor cycles on a storage cell. It also provides the advanced SQL offload capabilities and serves Oracle block when SQL offload processing is not possible. Cell SRB implements the IORM, and it has the ability to meter out IO bandwidth to the various database and consumer groups issuing the IO. The second component here, the MS, that is known as management service, and this implements a kind of web service for cell management commands and runs background monitoring threads. MS is the primary interface to administer, manage, as well as query the status of Exadata cell. So it works in cooperation with the Exadata cell command line interface, cell CLI, and processes most of the commands from cell CLI. The third one is RS service, and they ensure the ongoing functionality of Exadata software as well as the services. It monitors the heartbeat with the management service and the cell SRB process. If the process fails, then it is going to restart and send user a notification about that. So when you deal with a storage cell, like not on Exadata cloud service but on actual Exadata hardware, you will be issuing the cell CLI commands like alter cell restart service or alter cell restart service MS or all or RS. So new cells can be added to cell IP.ORA dynamically. And another thing on the right hand side, you need to understand is like how this database server or the ASM and the RDBMS instance are going to communicate with a storage cell. For establishing this connection between IO or ASM layer of database or ASM instance, like we have live cell, which is linked with DB or ASM, and they talk to cell SRB process. So in IDB, like which I explained earlier, that is the protocol used to communicate with the storage cell. There are other processes which are important here is like diskmon process, and they communicate with cell SRB. In diskmon, there are 2 processes. One is master diskmon and the other one is slave diskmon. So they are part of every instance and they communicate with master diskmon process. So they handle cell failures or IO fencing or IORM kind of functionalities within the Exadata system. The cell CLI commands, like they allow user interaction and configuration management server, displays the and manages the creation and deletion of grid disk and changes in hardware, SNMP traps, alerts, or email matrices. So that's the functionality of cell CLI command. So another thing, like if you note here, is like a smart flask SAP. We already discussed about that. 2 major components were like for flask logging as well as like keeping the all the active objects in the flask for faster database access. So they are the main feature provided by a smart flask SAP. Let's take a look at the disk layout and physical layout on Exadata. So on left hand side, you see database compute nodes. So it could be depending on the shape 2 to 8, and they are connected to InfiniBand switches, a storage cell, and a storage cell has the all the disk, like you have ASM disk and flash disk. And on right hand side, you see distribution of like how these disks are carved out. And on the compute nodes, there are 4 SAS drives, like which are basically presented as like created as partition, and we create wall. on top of it, and then like we mount it as a file system. On the storage cell level, like you have physical disk which is divided into partitions, and then we create cell disk out of it, then grid disk, and from grid disk like we create ASM disk, and from ASM disk like you create different kind of ASM disk groups including data, repo or sparse. So with that, like we'll move to Exadata Cloud Service Provisioning. And if you remember, like we discussed deployment blueprint, and we are again going to review how we can build this particular deployment architecture on OCI. So the main components here is like as you see, you have a VCN which is needed to create. Then you will be also looking at different subnets for your VCN, and these subnets will be required by your Exadata system as well as your application workload. And then like a public subnet like which is going to host the Bastion server. So let's get into that and see the different deployment workflow and how we are able to create that. So the typical deployment flow will look like creating a virtual cloud network. You need to create the gateways, which are NAT gateways or internet gateway or service gateways. So then like we need to think of our routing tables, and our routing tables will be also associated with different kind of security list. You need to decide on your DHCP options. We will be creating different subnets, private and public, and we will look at how to modify the security rules, and then we'll look into how to launch the Exadata database system once we are done with these networking prerequisites. So one thing to note here is for deploying Exadata Cloud Service in OCI, you should have IAM policy which will allow you to do these activities. So one of the example could be allow group DB admins to manage database family in tenancy. So let's take a look at what we need to consider when we are preparing our network. So we recommend using one of the private IP address range which are specified in RFC 1918. So you can pick any one of these, like 10 series 10000 slash whatever side of block you want to decide, 172 series and 192 series. So however, you can also use a publicly routable range. So another important point is VCN CIDR must not overlap with your on-prem network or another VCN you are going to peer with. So what I mean here is, so think of you are going to have XRCS deployed in two regions, and one for prod, one for non-prod or DR. So you have to keep that in mind, like you are going to communicate, so CIDRs should not be overlapping. The same case is valid, especially if you are communicating from your on-prem environment. So in your on-prem, you will be using certain IP address ranges, and then like you need to define those static routes when you come to Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. So there should not be any overlap, which might create any issue. So you need to have at least a VCN with at least two subnets, so one client and one backups for your XRCS system. Backup subnet needs object storage access. So VCN can be fully private, and this is one of the best practice to have your workload deployed on private subnets. So VCN needs a VCN resolver. You can create a custom VCN setup. You can choose different VCN IP ranges per region. And you should be keeping the VCN name short. So one of the tips is you can include the region so that you can differentiate which VCN belongs to which particular region. You should also keep the subnet name short, like you can include availability domain in the name so that it is easier to understand. Your host name could be a maximum of 64 characters. That will be like your node name, then your subnet VCN followed with oraclevcn.com. So just keep that in mind. The VCN settings, you need to create multiple security list per subnet. So it can have default VCN with default subnet or client or node access. You can also have a custom DNS. You can use hybrid DNS setup with forwarding to VCN resolver. You can use your local DNS to resolve the specific VCN DNS information. And gateways, like you have to have the static route for your backup to object storage. So we'll get into like creating this networking setup, and we will look at like how XRCS can be launched after preparing these prerequisite steps. So that step one is always creating a virtual cloud network. For that, you need to log in to your Oracle Cloud Infrastructure console. You will navigate to networking, virtual cloud networks, and then you have an option to create a VCN. So on right hand side, you see the screen like this is create virtual cloud network screen. Here you have to select your compartment. So in my case, I have selected compartment as Bal Sarma, and then you need to provide a name to your VCN. So you see, I've provided a name here. There are two options to select from. One is create virtual cloud network only, and the other one is network plus related resource. So for Exadata deployment on OCI, we recommend to create a virtual cloud network only, so that you can create different subnets, whatever is required for your provisioning, and define your own rules, and that will help with the deployment. So you need to provide the CIDR block. Here I have selected 10.0.0.0/16 as my CIDR block. Make sure that like DNS resolution, like you can keep it checked, like use DNS hostname in the VCN. These fields like DNS label or DNS domain name, they will be populated with your inputs, and you are done. So you can create, just click on create virtual cloud network, and then it would be able to create that. And once that is done, like it will appear in your OCI console. So on left hand side, you see like I have this VCN Bal, which shows the status as available. It means this VCN is created, and the same thing you will look into your environment while provisioning. The next step is to create a NAT gateway. And as I explained, like instances on private subnet can initiate connection to public internet, and connection initiated from the internet are blocked. And we want our deployment to be more secure on a private subnet. We don't want to expose database compute on public internet, and that is the reason like we are creating a NAT gateway here. So for creating a NAT gateway, you have to navigate to networking again, then virtual cloud network, and then create a NAT gateway. And it just asks you like which compartment you want to create that one. So compartment will be selected, and then you have to provide a name, and then it will confirm you that NAT gateway is created, and it will again appear in the console for you. So once we are done with the NAT gateway, we have to also create the service gateway, which is needed for our cloud backup. And it allows access to object storage, and later we'll see how to configure your backup route table so that Exadata backup can travel to object storage within OCI. So for doing this, you need to again navigate to networking, virtual cloud network, and click on select the VCN, create a service gateway. So in this example, I have given a name as SG_Bal, and the services are OCI IAD object storage. So that represents my backups are going to reside on this object storage in S1 data center region. So once you have created your service gateway, now you need to create your routing tables. And virtual cloud network uses virtual route tables to send traffic out of the VCN. And each of the rule specifies a destination CIDR block and the target. It's what is going to be your next hop for any traffic that matches the CIDR. For Exadata, you create two route tables for client traffic and for backup traffic. So for creating this one, like you have to again go to your VCN, and then from VCN, like you will see an option to create the routing table. Here you need to provide again the compartment and the name of the routing table. Within the routing rules, like you can specify like how they're going to communicate. So I have NAT gateway, and that is the destination CIDR is 0.0.0.0/0. And target NAT gateway is going to be used ng_bal, which I created earlier. Same with service gateway, you are going to specify that and select your service gateway, which you have already created earlier. So these rules like could be separate also. You can split this routing table or routing rules into two different, but here I have included both of these rules within one single routing table and rules. So the routing tables in VCN, so as I said, like brief was my private routing table, and that was created. There were two different rules within it we saw in previous phase. So one of that is like communicating with NAT gateway, and the other one was for service gateway. And then like we have another default route table for VCN wall, and it has access to internet gateway, and this particular rule will be used only for the Bastion host, which is going to be hosted on the public subnet. So they need access to the internet gateway. So routing table in this particular compartment, so one is default route table for VCN, and then the PRIV, which is going to be used by Exadata Cloud Service. And you might see like in the routing table, I have few more security list created. One is FS access. So in my example, like I have used a file service, and file service also needs like certain rules to be written in the routing table. So depending on your configuration, which component you are going to use, like you need to have corresponding security list within the compartment, and it should be associated with the routing table. So once you are done with your routing table, you create the security list, and security list controls ingress and egress rules that specifies the type of traffic allowed in and out. So you need to configure your security list at the subnet level, which means that all instances in a given subnet are subject to the same set of rules. So for creating that, again, you will go back to your VCN, which you have already created, and then it will define your security rules. So here, in default security list for this VCN, I have three rules over here. So one, you see that like I have a CIDR block 10.0.0/16, that is my source. And from there, I have opened up rule for TCP and ICMP for all of the port range, right? So it allows me TCP traffic for port all and ICMP traffic for all types and ports. And this was one of the requirement for Exadata Cloud Service deployment, because within VCN we want to communicate with all the other IP address ranges. Like we have different components, a storage cell and things, so these two protocols are needed to be open. In this example, I have just included for I am using a file service, so I have a FS access as a security list. I have a rule for Bastion server, and that is nothing but like source. I have given all of the IPs, TCP port, and like it is listening on port number 22. So I can do a TCP traffic on this port 22 from any other server. So the ingress rule for file service access is like starting with 0.0.0/0. I have opened up few ports here, TCP port for on 111, and then TCP traffic for port 2048 to 50, and UDP port for both of these. So these were requirement for file service, and I have just enabled the ingress rules for them. So now you need to also revisit your DHCP option. So VCN uses DHCP option to automatically provide configuration information to the instance when they boot up. So each VCN comes with a default set of DHCP option with initial values, and you can either keep it or you can change it. But in my example, I have not modified anything. Like I'm going with the default DHCP options for my Exadata deployment. So once you are done with your VCN routing table and security list, you need to create different subnets. And if you remember the diagram we were discussing, we had three private subnet and one public subnet for Bastion host. So we'll go ahead and create those subnets. And subnets is basically a subdivision of VCN. Each subnet in a VCN exists in a single availability domain, and it also consists of a contiguous range of IP addresses, and this would not overlap with other subnet in the cloud network. So as I said, like four different subnets we'll be creating. Two of these will be required by Exadata Cloud Service deployment, that is data and backup, and one for Bastion host, and the last one I am going to create for my applications, which I'm going to host on Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. So for creating, like the series of steps has to be performed. Like you will go ahead and click on your VCN, which you have already created. In the resources section, you will click on subnets, and then click create subnet. And when the dialog box comes, like you need to provide a name to the subnet. You will be also selecting what CIDR block it is going to use. You will be selecting the availability domain in which these subnets are going to be created, and you need to also select the routing table that you have already created before. So for XRCS, I will be selecting priv as my routing table. For subnet access, like you should be selecting private subnet. Only for the Bastion server, we will be selecting the public subnet. So steps are going to be same for all of the subnets except selection of the private versus public. So we will see like how they look like. This diagram is a little lengthy, but I have just stacked them. Like I am creating four subnets, I have given a name to it, and I have selected private subnet as a subnet access. And in case of my Bastion server subnet, I have selected public one. Then all other things are just left, like use DNS hostname in the subnet. So I have not changed any other option. And later I can always modify the security list which is needed to be attached with my subnet. So once you have created your subnets, you can attach the security list. And here you can see like in private backup subnet, I'm attaching a security list, which is default security list for VCN, as well as another security list, FS access. So the routing table is going to use the private routing table, which has access to the NAT gateway as well as the service gateway component. And they are using the default security list, which we seen earlier. This example is showing like for backup subnet, you need to have a bucket already created that will be used for configuring Exadata backup later on. So I have created a bucket in my object storage. The name is balxd bucket, and that I will be using for configuring the Exadata backup on cloud storage. Once you are done, you can also add rules to the security list, and these rules are nothing but like to update your security list and provide appropriate ingress and egress rules to allow the traffic. So you will be going to the console and you need to select the VCN, and in resources tab you have security list, and click the default security list for the VCN, and like you need to specify TCP and ICMP traffic between both subnet data and backup. So that's what like you've seen in earlier diagram, I was enabling this TCP and ICMP protocol for my XRCS backup. So the idea is like both the subnets should talk, and TCP ICMP protocol should be enabled between them to function correctly. So the content of my default security list for VCN, like it has, once we have added those rules, like these two, we just saw like how we enable for my data subnet and backup subnet. And then like I have another ingress rule that is for my Bastion host. So one of the thing like in this example, like I have used 0000/0, it is just for demonstration purpose. You can add ingress and egress security rules which are allowed by your company security policies, and you have always an ability to restrict this one, right? Like you don't want to connect to even Bastion host from entire world, right? Like you can specify your own CIDR block which is there in your data center or the place from where you are connected. So once you are done with this networking setup steps, like now it is time to launch the Exadata database system from OCI console. This is a lengthy slide, but I will take you through different screenshots and explain like what are different sections to fill in for deploying an Exadata system. And in the demo also you will see the same thing. So ideally what we are doing is like for launching Exadata database system, you need to log in to your OCI console, and you have to navigate to databases, and then you need to select bare metal VM and Exadata tab. Once you select that, like you need to select your compartment, and then you have to click launch database system. So that will open up a dialog box, and it will ask for certain entries to be provided by you before it can launch the database system. So it will ask for a display name. You can provide any name to your database system you want. And you need to select the availability domain where Exadata database system will reside. So one thing to understand here is like when you subscribe to Exadata cloud service, you have already requested in which availability domain you want that system to be hosted. So based on that, you have created all the network resources which will be available in that particular availability domain. So that you have to keep in mind. You will select the availability domain where Exadata database system is going to reside. You will select the shape of your Exadata cloud service. And this shape, as we discussed, it could be quarter rack, half rack, or full rack. And based on your subscription, you are going to select. So all the shapes which will start with 2.92 and like two more, right? So they represent X7s, but the shape which will start with Exadata quarter 1 dot something, they represents the X6 version. So that you have to keep in mind. Then you need to provide the cluster name. So in my example, I have given XTP cluster. You need to also specify how many CPU core you want for your XRCS system. So in my example, I'm going to give it 6. So it is again like how many CPU you have already subscribed to, right? Or you can provide that name. And as I said, like it can go in a quarter rack, it can go up to 92. So you might have subscribed to 10, 12, or 20, or maybe 92, right? So that you can provide. You need to select the license type, and license type could be bring your own license or license included option. So if it is a fresh environment, like you need to know what you have subscribed to, whether it's you are bringing your own license to OCI cloud, or like you are going with license included pass option. Then you need to have your SSS keys, which will be used for communicating with the compute later. So you need to upload that SSS key. You need to also select the storage percentage, like data storage percentage. So depending on if you want to have a local backup, if you want to have a sparse disk group. So a sparse disk group is for snapshots and like thin provision databases. So based on that, the total data storage percentage will differ. So we will see when we log into the demo environment, and we will understand it better. So once you provide like these basic details, and then like it asks a few details for networking, which we have already created, means virtual cloud network. You need to provide a name of that, the VCN, which you have already created. For client subnet, you need to provide the subnet we created earlier. For backup subnet, you have to select that. You need to provide a hostname prefix, like xdprod, for example. So think of like why it is important is whatever hostname prefix you will provide, the cluster is going to add 1, 2, depending on like how many compute node it has. So if xdprod is the hostname prefix, the hostname will look like 1 for first compute and 2 at the end for second compute. Then you need to provide the database name. This is just the starter database. You can pick whatever name you want. And you need to also provide the database version. So database version you have to select very carefully. I have in this example selected 12.102, but one thing you should be knowing, XRCS, as part of deployment, it installs all the Oracle software homes, means starting from 11G till 18C. So you will see 4 database home only if you go with the highest version selected in the database version tab. So if you select 18C, you will have 11G database home, 12.102, 12.2, and 18C database home available when you will log in to your provision system. If you select 12, then like you will have grid infrastructure compatible only till 12C. So your grid infrastructure is going to be 12C, so you won't be able to create the 18C database later on, like if you want to. So then you will be entering a PDB name here, and you will be confirming the OLTP or DSS, and then once these all inputs are done, you will click on launch database system. So this is the note, like I briefly explained, like you should be selecting the database version as 18x for getting grid version 18 to be installed, so that you can create database version 11x till 18 at later point in time. So the same thing, like few screenshots from my environment. So when you click on launch database system, like you had DB system information where I given a display name, selected availability domain. I selected Exadata from the shape type and I have also selected Exadata quarter rack with 2.92, and then given a cluster name, CPU core count, I want 6. So you cannot give it 7 or 9, like it should be always an even number, because Exadata cloud service has like either 2 node or 4 node or 8 node, right, in the say. So this would be distributed accordingly, so there should not be odd number. We are not supporting that now. Then I have selected the license type. I have uploaded the SSS keys here, xdpkey.pub. So you should have it created using any key generator tool, and you need to upload it. Then the storage allocation, it varies depending on your selection. So if you select database backups on Exadata storage only, not the sparse disk group, then like data distribution and record distribution is going to change. So if you go without local backup, it could be data distribution will be 80% and 20% for echo. But if you go with database backups on Exadata storage as well, that is nothing but local backups. So that percentage will again change. So it will become 50% data, and then remaining as reco. And like if you select sparse, then the sparse. So you can play with that one depending on your architectural needs. Like you will select this option. In advanced options, like you have only character set which you can change. The disk redundancy is always going to be high on Exadata cloud service, so you cannot change it to normal, which used to do on like on-prem Exadata environment. So high disk redundancy is nothing but three-way mirroring, and it is required for all of the Exadata saves. So after providing that, like in the same screen, you will have to provide the database information, means provide a database name, the version you need to select, and this we discussed, you should be going with the higher version so that you will get multiple database homes, which will provide you flexibility to create the desired version later. And you need to provide a PDB name, the admin passwords. It should be a complex password based on the rule. And once you are done, this is the last section, and which provides you launch database system. But there is another section which captures network information in the same screen. I have kept it here. So you select your VCN, the client subnet, backup subnet, and hostname prefix. So that was the only input, and you can go ahead and click on launch database system, and it will start deploying the Exadata in OCI. And this Exadata deployment is going to take some time. We will take a look at later. So ideally it takes 4 hours for quarter rack configuration. And when it is getting provisioned, you will see that a status as provisioning within your console. And it will be keep updating these details as it progresses. So this is how it might look like. This is still provisioning. It is shows you like there are two nodes. Nodes are nothing but compute nodes, and database is one. So two compute nodes in a quarter rack configuration, and it will vary depending on the shape selection. It shows here what shape I have configured, how many CPU core count I'm looking at, the disk redundancy, at which port it is running on, and the scan IP, and things will get populated later. Here in this diagram, you see like it shows my client subnet, backup subnet, hostname prefix and all. So depending on what input you provide, like it will give a name to it. So here like 2 and 1, this represents like two compute nodes, and xdprod by my hostname prefix. Floating IP is not available, which will be populated once the Exadata system is provisioned on OCI. And this floating IP is nothing but your virtual IPs, right, which is in a rack scenario. Another thing like we discussed in the blueprint is the Bastion server. And for Bastion server, Exadata system is on private subnet. You need to connect it using Bastion host, right? So ideally, what I do is like I create a configuration file for SSH on your client host to access the deployment of XRCS on private subnet using proxy. So this example or a screenshot is from my MacBook. I go to SSH and look at the config file. I made entries in it, right? So I have a host Bastion which is using this particular SSH key, that is, this is my private key here. The username is OPC, as OPC is the default user which gets created for either computer or databases, right? So this is the user with which you will log in to your either compute or Exadata compute nodes. And later, you know, on XRCS, you can do sudo to root or grid user or Oracle user. So this is just a typical example, like how we connect from a Bastion server. So I have first entry as Bastion server, the host name. This reflects the IP address, then user and the identity file. Then I have 10.096.2. That is again on a private subnet, but this is going to use a key. You can have different keys. I am just showing a demo, so I have the same key used here. But there is proxy command which goes through SSH Bastion, which is defined here, and take me to this private subnet application. So same way, like my Exadata is having IP address as 0.3 and 0.2, and this is using a SSH key, and it again goes from the proxy command here. So if you have done with this particular configuration, you can anytime enter SSH and the IP address, and you will be directly reaching out to that compute node. And for Bastion host, this was my stateful rules. Like I opened it from 0000/0. I have opened a port 22 here, and that's why like I will be able to log in there. So once the database system is provisioned, now you will be looking at how to verify the database system, looking at different information, right? So for doing that, like you will logging to that particular compute node. Here I have connected from OPC user, right? So you logged in, and then you can always do sudo hyphen s, which will take you to root user. And then like the familiar commands are dbus, CLI, dbm, info. So that provides, dbus CLI is a command line interface available on XRCS that will provide you like what host name is, what is the home location of the database, what is the patch level which is deployed, what is the name of the database. So these are few simple commands to validate like what I did and how you can verify. You can again use dbus CLI database status command with argument as database name, and it will tell you like which instances are running on which particular host and what are their associated home. So in this last example, it's showing like how I'm doing SSH to my XRCS node. So after logging, you can always use grep-i machine types and grep for your machine type in database machine.xml. So this file resides under Opt Oracle Support Tools one command. So it shows me X72 Elastic Rack high capacity 10 terabyte as my machine type. So just some verification steps here. You can log in to the ASM instance. For doing that, from OPC user, you will have to do sudo to grid, and then SQL plus, and you can look for select fail group, count star, VSMS, ASM underscore disk by fail group. You will see all of the failure groups. You can do ASM CMD commands. So nothing new here, the same thing which you already doing for your managing your rack ASM instances. You can run all of those commands here on as an ASM user. So another screenshot is showing the df-h output, and this is what I wanted to explain you. So if you remember, in my deployment, I selected 12.102 as my database version. So my grid version is 12.2, and I have only three homes available, 11.204, 12.102, and 12.201. So advantage of these three homes, like anytime you have ability to create database versions, from OCI console. So you can create a 11G database if you want, you can create 12.102 or 12.2. And to support this, 12.201 grid is going to help you. But if you could have selected 18C as your database version, you could have seen here four entries. So there will be one more home for 18C. And the starter database is also going to be 18C if you go with that. But you have opportunity to create any one of these later. Another thing to note here is with XRCS deployment, you will see a ACFS mount point to be available on your compute node. And in this case, it is roughly 800 GB size. Why we use ACFS? ACFS is nothing but ASM cluster file system, right? So one thing which I said earlier when we started that on XRCS, we cannot add block volumes, right? But in a database environment, you need to have a storage space available for doing a staging or like having some of the database files. It could be data pump or like any other staging activity, right? Or maybe like you want to transfer Armin backup to Exadata system, which can be later used for restoring, right? So for all of those interim tasks, you should be creating an ASM cluster file system on the Exadata system. So there is nothing new, like if this size is not enough for you, you can always create one more mount point, right? And for doing that, you will have to log in to your grid user. You can always issue alter disk group name. Like you can carve out ASM cluster file system either from data or recovery area, right? So data, and so the syntax would be alter disk group data add volume, and the volume name and the size you will specify, right? Then you can always check from grid user, like ASM CMD vol info command will show you what exactly is created. And the next step is to create a file system with volume as a root user. Right, so you will be taking advantage of mkfs-t, ACFS, and then you will specify the volume name. And the as part of the syntax, you will be specifying the version and like which a specific mount point like under WSM is representing that. And then like you will be able to format that one. And once the format is complete, like you can add the file system to grid as a root user. And then like you will have to start the new ACFS resource as root, right? So these things are documented. It will be available on Moz, which you can use. And once like this ACFS mount point, which is of the desired size is created, you can always mount it. You can change the permission and specify which user is going to own that. So that's about ACFS file system. So a few of the important things to consider here is the deployment time, right? So as I said in the beginning, the a quarter rack is going to take 4 hours for deployment. A half rack takes 6 hours and a full rack takes 8 hours. For secure erase of the environment, it takes 4 days, but termination could be in minutes. So secure erase has to go through several data sanitization after if customers goes from the environment, like we have to make sure disk is completely scrubbed. So they take time. In terms of passwords, you should not use sysystem or Oracle. Like you should use a complex password like SSS keys. Only use one with no spaces in the comment field. These are some just the best practices, like to keep that in mind. So you can adjust the huge pages depending on the database and memory requirement. You will find a Moz note available in the Oracle support site. For connecting to the database, especially with any application, you should take a look at like how services are configured. If you want to modify, this command srvctl modify service hyphen db database name and then the service name, failover type as transaction, replay anytime 300, failover retry 30, failover delay notification true. So this is just an example you can use to configure or make sure your services are configured properly for your application use. So you should be connecting to the scan, of course, right? And you should not be connecting to a specific instance, otherwise you will not get benefit of this transparent application failover. So setting up Exadata, we have other methods also available, like it can be done from console. This is what we were looking at. You can also take advantage of OCI CLI command or Terraform scripts or through SDK. So different functions supported by XRCS is created or terminated, scale up and down, create or delete database forms. So you can always scale without any downtime. So you can scale from 0 to 92. You can 2 to 4, 4 to 6, like in even numbers, you can increment the OCPUs on XRCS system. Another way to launch an Exadata database system is using OCICL, so OCIDB system launch with various options. So this is one of the example. You need to specify whether you need a sparse disk group or like what is your subnet ID, compartment ID, availability domain. Just remember, like each of the object within OCI console is associated with the OSID, right? OSID is like the one like which uniquely distinguishes a particular entity on the Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. So from there, like you will have to log into your console to get those information, or if you have OCICL command line installed, you can fetch those informations which will be used for launching a database system here. So this link provides you more detail on like how to do it command line. So some of the sizing and consolidation best practice for XRCS. So in X7, we introduced a new pricing model, right? And that new pricing model is like OCPUs and infrastructure have been separated, right? So upon creation, infrastructure is charged 744 hours. So this is not designed to do a quick test, right? There are no CPU minimums, means zero CPU will shut down the VMs. Only infrastructure is charged. Don't use less than 4 OCPU per node. No imperity allowed today. Size for a storage capacity and IOPS, and grow CPU by demand, means XRCS shape cannot change at the moment, right? You would be able to scale within the shape. So only method, like if you are getting into that kind of situation, you will have to depend on data guard for migration. So consolidation on XRCS, CPU count you are familiar with, right? This you used to use for instance caging and all, or to distribute the workload. So for production, you can use a partitioning approach. So enabled cores should be sum of CPU count. So you should not do over subscription on the, or over provisioning on the XRCS for production environment. For test and dev, you can always over provision, right? Enabled core could be greater than 3x sum of CPU count. You can use the resource manager for intra DB workload, and you should also be enabling the IORM for IO distribution. So IORM options are also available on OCI console, so we will take a look at it. So for signing to Oracle Cloud, you need to provide your account information, and then like my account information OCI enablement, I click on next. And then like you need to authenticate, right? So you provide your credentials and click on sign in. Once you sign in to your Oracle Cloud, you will be presented with your dashboard. So you can navigate to the service. So here I'm talking about Exadata, and that will be available under database here. So just to make sure you are able to view this. So you need to select the database and it will take you to database page. So in my database system, in this demo environment, in my compartment, I have a XT prod, and there is another database which is non-Exadata. I'm looking at XT prod here. So in the previous slides you seen, right? Like these were the subnets I created for private and like for data and for backups, right? My host name prefix, my scan name is populated here. Scan IPs, it uses 3 IP addresses for resolving the services or providing the load balancing, right? The name of the cluster, the disk redundancy level. I have set it to CPU core count 2. It is just my demo environment, so I don't want to burn my credits. So I have set it to 2. And it is a Exadata quarter rack 2.92. I have few databases already created here. So you see, I have two databases, BAL test and BMS prod. Both are of version 12.102. Then I have two compute nodes in it. And it also shows you the private IP address of both the nodes. So this is the node like through which I need to connect to my compute node. And these floating IPs, which is nothing but VIPs, right, is shown here. So let me take you to my networking, means how I build this particular system. I know this deployment takes time, like it takes 4 hours. So I will try to show you all the prep steps here. And for doing all of the preparation steps, you need to go under networking, and then you need to select the virtual cloud network tab. So in my virtual cloud network, you see that I am in my compartment, which is Bal Sharma here. And then I have different VCNs already created, right? So the VCN which I was talking earlier with you, by VCN underscore BAL, so that is the VCN which starts with CIDR 10.0.0/16, and it is associated with the default routing table. So let me click that and show you the various constructs within this. So within a VCN, all these things, subnets, the routing tables, internet gateways, security list or DHCP options, NAT gateways, service gateways. So all those networking components are associated with this particular VCN. Right, you see all of my subnets within it. So creation is simple. Like if you want to create a VCN, you will go ahead, click on create virtual cloud network. You need to provide a name. Then this is the option we wanted, right? Create virtual cloud network only, so that we can create our subnets and things later, right? You have to provide one CIDR range. So this is a valid CIDR range. It could be anyone, like 172 series or 196 series. Then no other things we need to specify. You can use the same DNS resolution. So this is the step to create a virtual cloud network. So once a VCN is done, like you have an option of creating the subnets, right? So as well as routing table and internet gateways. Creating subnet will ask you the subnet name, which you have seen before. Right, it could be a regional subnet, it could be like availability domain specific. So regional subnet has come recently. In my example, I was showing you only the ADS specific subnets. So either you can do that or you can create the regional subnet. You need to select the availability domain in which you want to create it. You will have to provide the CIDR block. You need to select the routing table, and then you need to specify whether subnet is going to be private or public. So for my XRCS deployment, I created private subnets, right? Then the DHCP options, we selected default DHCP option for my VCN, and that is the only input, and you will go ahead and create this subnet. So let me go back here and show you these subnets which I have already created. So within my VCN, I have these four subnets: for Bastion host, for my application, and for a backup subnet, and for data subnet. You can always see, click on that, and you'll be able to see what options you have provided. So a name to the subnet, the compartment information, default DHCP options, the routing table. The routable compartment is this, and routing table is prev. So whatever routing table you will have, so I have only two: default routable as well as prev. So prev is the one which shows access to NAT gateway and service gateway. So I have selected that, and then the security list which is applicable. So I have two security lists selected from here. So I have total three security lists created in my environment for the blueprint. So file access is related to file service, the Bastion host, and the default security list. So same is the case with the public subnet as well. So let me show you public subnet. So this is my public subnet, which is associated with routing table as default routable for VCN. All of my private subnets are associated with routing table prev. So the example of that one is like it is only communicating with NAT gateway and service gateway. So this is my private routing rule and routing table. Internet gateways, as I said, like I'm using this one for my Bastion host because I don't have a Cisco IPsec connectivity, right, to OCI. So I have created this internet gateway, and that is associated with my Bastion host. So Bastion host security rule is this one, port 22, which we discussed. Default security list, as I said, like TCP and ICMP has to be enabled in order to communicate between the data subnet and the backup subnet on XRCS. Then I have another rule for 0000/0. It is for a specific port range which I wanted to allow traffic for. This is very specific to the file service, and like these are the ports we need to enable. So I have created this ingress rule. You can always edit the rule, and it will take you through the option to specify like which CIDR block or like for service you want the rule to be, and you need to specify the source port and destination port here. So this is how it looks like. If you want to do another, you will go ahead, specify the source CIDR from where you want to open up, and then the source port and destination port. These are optional. By default, it is allowed for all. So this was about the networking, and when you are done with your virtual cloud networking stuff, right, you will go ahead to bare metal VM and accelerator system. So this is the place where you have to come for deployment, and you will click on launch database system. So you will specify your name. You need to select the availability domain. For Exadata system, you'll be selecting Exadata. You need to specify the shape. So this is what I was discussing. You have an option to select either these three options or this one, right? So two represents, all these two dots represents the X7 versions of Exadata cloud service, and all ones are for X6 versions. So you will have to look at what service you have subscribed to, and based on that, you will be selecting. So here total node count is by default populated to 2. If you go with 2.184 means half rack, it is going to be 4 compute nodes. So you need to specify a cluster name, cluster, provide a name to it, how many CPU cores you want to be for your compute nodes, so 4 or 6. So based on your subscription, you are going to provide that. You will be going with license included or BYOL. So depending on your subscription, again, you need to specify the SSH public key here. So I've selected a key randomly just to show you. Once you provide these details, like you have a storage allocation. And as I said, if you don't go with these two options, the distribution is 80% data and 20% reco. But if you want a local backup to be done, then it reduces, so 40% data and 60% reco as a distribution. But if you again want a sparse disk group, so that's 15% is getting reserved here for your sparse disk group use cases. So not sure like if you have you know like what is the advantage of a sparse disk group, but it is used for creating databases from a test master database. So test master is a read-only copy of your production database, and that is used to create additional databases for development, UAT, and test purposes. So all the sparse sparse disk group databases are going to be thin provision. It uses copy and write. So the size of the database when they are created from your test master is going to be in few MBs, and or it will look like a full-fledged database for users, but all the read operation goes to test master and all the writes are performed locally, right? And if you want to or intend to use this feature for your test dev and non-prod use cases, you have to select it during deployment time. So if you miss out, again, like we are not providing any other way to enable this sparse disk group functionality later within the environment. You will have to redeploy because it is related to all of your disk groups, right? They are already running on high kind of configuration, means three-way mirror mode, and you will have to destroy and recreate. So even like recreating the disk group is not supported. So you have to decide like if you want to use the functionality sparse disk group in your deployment. once you have done with this decision, like this redundancy, you cannot change it. It is going to be always high. You have an option to change your time zone. So UTC is by default, or like you can select any other time zone from this browser. Then you need to select the networking information. So the VCN you have created already. So think of, I have a VCN. Then like there should be subnets created in my VCN. So for client subnet, I have private data. For backup subnets, I created a private backup, right? A hostname prefix test has to be provided. And then you are done with the networking information, and only information left is database information. So we'll go ahead and give it a name. If you click on this display all available versions, it will show you like different versions available. So right now in my tenancy, I can see 11.204 till 18.00 version, right? So if you want like back support, like all of the latest 18C grid, you should be going with this, because it is not going to force you to have all of your databases on 18C. You have an option, like you can always create a database later of either 11G or 12C, 12.102 or 12.2 or 18C, if you go ahead with the latest version upgrade. So give it a name. So by default, the starter database which gets created on OCI XRCS is always going to be a multi-tenant container database. So you need to provide the PDB name. Give a strong password here. And what kind of database workload you want to deploy. Another options are character sets, like which can be changed from here. And then at the end, like you have an option to launch the database system. So don't worry, like if you want to have a non-CDB database, that is also supported as of today on XRCS environment, but it is not possible from the console. We have APIs, DBus APIs to perform a non-CDB database creation. So that you'd be able to see in my different module. But these are the inputs, and you will go ahead and click on the launch database system. So once you do that, like your database will appear in your under bare metal VM and Exadata tag under databases. And once the database is there, you can always create another databases. Like I want to create one more database. It asks me, right, from the console, you can provide database name. You need to select the version. So since my grid is at level 12.2, I do not see 18C as a version. For simplicity, I will select 11.204. Just give a password. And you would be able to complete creating this database. So this is the only input. Since Oracle Homes are already there, any version can be created. But keep that in mind, like you have one single VM on each of the compute node, right? And these will be in the different database homes. So 11G database will be under 11G database home we saw earlier, and same with any other version. So this is how you create, and it takes some time to appear here under this console. So this is one of the way, like you go ahead and create the database. We have APIs method also to create any database on Exadata cloud service. Few of the things if you note here is, like, unlike the other DBus services, you do not see backups and patches. So these backups and patches are done through APIs as of now. Backup is one-time configuration using backup underscore API, which we'll see in the next module. And patches are also supported through XRDBC multi. So again, like that is through APIs, which might change like in the future. We can have automatic backup and patching operations here. You can always scale up and down from this console. I can do a scale to 4, like it is just going to scale this up, like it is not going to impact the availability of your database. You can also update, so while updating, the color will change, indicating that there is a change happening on the system, but database will be, you will be able to access and things will be happening. So once that is done, like you can always like add more SSH keys to it. You can update the IORM settings of the database system. So here, like I try to show you how you can deploy Exadata system, and then we also looked at the architecture of Exadata system and the deployment best practices. Some of the service management feature within Exadata, how to scale it, or like how to add SSH keys and all, and then consolidation best practices and sizing. So I believe like it is useful for you, and thanks for watching this video.